I'm going to talk about works that we call early Netherlandish painting, early Netherlandish art. And so I want you to know what that means. And let me give you a little bit of background, of context, both geographic and political, in which to understand where did this name come from. Well, first, the Netherlands are the low lands. And the word nether means low, the word lands means lands. So Nederlands, or what we call the Netherlands, are the low lands. And this is not just the country that today we call the Netherlands. That's the North Netherlands, or it's the Kingdom of the Netherlands. And sometimes we even say Holland, which is a part of the Netherlands. But the way we're using it is the larger meaning. The countries that are at or near sea level in a particular geographic area. That's why they're low. They're geographically low, near sea level. And this includes the countries that today are called Belgium, Luxembourg, the Kingdom of the Netherlands, and a small part of northern France. Now, obviously, the countries that we have today are not the same nations or countries or principalities that existed in earlier centuries. Belgium, for example, came into being in the 19th century after the defeat of Napoleon. And Belgium is, and Luxembourg, are the southern lowlands, the lowlands of the south. We sometimes use the word Flanders to describe that. Today, of course, Flanders is the westernmost counties of Belgium, but we often use it more generally. You know, this southern Netherlands are Flemish. And then the North Netherlands are the country that today we call the Netherlands. The Kingdom of the Netherlands, we sometimes, as I say, call it Holland as well. I should probably also mention the language. The language is Nederlands, same name as the country or the area. And a lot of times in English, we don't say Nederlands or Netherlandish, we say Dutch. Dutch is a misnomer, but it's part of the English language, so we have to deal with it. It is, as I say, it's a misnomer because it comes from Deutsch or German. And, you know, they don't want to be called Germans, especially after World War II. The language that we call Flemish is the same language. It's Nederlands. If you were to buy an English-Dutch dictionary for translation, it would say Nederlands and English. As well as Dutch and English, but it could say Flemish. Flemish and Dutch, what's the difference? Some pronunciation of some sounds? I suppose it's probably closer than American English and British English, which are both the same language with a few variations. Now, the term early Netherlandish is referring to the 15th century, primarily, in the Netherlands. Sometimes a little bit of early 16th century or maybe a little bit of the 14th century as well would be included in this. But art from the lowlands before the 17th century, essentially, which some people call the golden age of Dutch art. Of course, being a 15th century specialist, I might take exception to that. So it's the early Netherlandish period that we're talking about. And Netherlandish, of course, comes from the German. Two very notable books on this period were called early Netherlandish painting. The first one was written in the 1920s and 30s, and it's a multi-volume thing, by Max J. Friedlander, who was a German art historian who is known as the great connoisseur of early Netherlandish painting. And he looked at all of these paintings, and he put them in groups. He attributed them to particular artists, or he made groups with conventional names. So he did a tremendous amount of work. Now, sometimes we will go back and we will disagree with what he said, but he is the basis for this type of scholarship dealing with the paintings from the lowlands. And in this period, most of the survival is from the southern area, the Flemish area of Belgium area. There's been less survival of the things from the North Netherlands. I was going to tell you about Friedlander's book. Friedlander's book, or multi-volume books, was called Alter Nederlandisch Malerei, or Early Netherlandish Painting. And then in the early 1950s, Erwin Panofsky, who was a German art historian, he came over to the United States to give a series of lectures at Princeton, and Hitler took power. Now, Panofsky was Jewish. And incidentally, I should mention that sometimes people are surprised to find that the greatest Christian iconographer, or iconographer of Christian art, was Jewish, but he was. You can study areas of history, even though you may not share the beliefs. For example, a historian could study Nazi Germany and not believe in Nazi Germany. So it is scholarship. It's not, we're going to be doing a lot of Christian art. We're not trying to tell you to believe this. We're talking about this historically, and what the people of the time believed and how that informed their paintings. So Panofsky wrote a book in the early 1950s called Early Netherlandish Painting. And frankly, those two books were the textbooks, and I don't want to say the Bible, but those were some of the really important books that the students of early Netherlandish painters study. Okay, let's look at a map of Europe. And you can see there's a couple of little rectangles that have been cut out. And the one that's uppermost shows you the lowlands, or parts of the lowlands, Flanders essentially, and a little bit of the North Netherlands. And you can see where some of these cities, which of course still exist, are. You can pick out Brussels, Bruges, Antwerp, Ghent. And you'll notice where the lowlands are situated, right across from the channel with England. One of the most important items of trade was the English wool trade with the Netherlands. And so the English wool would be imported into Flanders, into the lowlands, and the Flemish weavers would turn it into beautiful cloth, which in many cases, some of it were brocades and tapestries and luxury goods. And of course, the Belgians are still known for their tapestries today. So geography has a great impact on the economic situation of the country. And these lowlands were a capitalist mercantile economy, as they say. Then, a little bit to the south is France. A little bit to the east is Germany. If you were coming from today, even, you're in Brussels, for example, and you want to go to Germany, you just go straight. The train station takes you straight to Aachen and then on to Cologne, and go the opposite direction to the west, and you go right to Ghent and Bruges. And these follow routes that have been there for centuries. So some of the artists, for example, Hans Memling, came from Germany. And I mean, he didn't leave a travelogue, but just knowing where the roads are, it's a good guess, you might say, that he may have gone through Cologne and then gone over to Brussels and then to Bruges, periods of years. You can see where Italy is. We'll come to Italy later. France is. Okay. Politics. In the 15th century, the lowlands were ruled first by the Count of Holland, who at that time was John of Bavaria. Before then, it had been his brother, who was William. And John of Bavaria died in January of 1425. And he had no male heir, who probably should have inherited the territory was his niece, because she was the daughter of the previous count, his brother. But she had been a minor when he died. So the brother just, took over and, set himself up as the count. And when he died, Jacqueline, or Jacoba, wanted her territory back, but it wasn't to happen. That's a very sad story, actually. The Duke of Burgundy, and you may know, of course, where Burgundy is. It's where the wine country is, around Dijon in, if you were going north and south, it would be central, but if you're going east and west, it would be eastern France, right around Dijon. So the Duke of Burgundy claimed the territory that the Count of Holland ruled. And ironically, his claim was based on the fact that a woman shouldn't inherit. And yet his claim was through the female line, so go figure. But at any rate, he was powerful, and Philip the Good prevailed. And from there on, much of the lowlands was ruled by dukes and a duchess of Burgundy. Oh, and here are some of the names. And well, I'll just start off even before then. We have, before they acquired the territory in the late 14th century, there is Philip the Bold, and then his son is Jean, or John the Fearless. And he is murdered by the French. And then his son, Philip the Good, the one who took over the territory of the lowlands, who added the lowlands to the territories of the Dukes of Burgundy. Philip the Good, for a while, allied himself with the English in the Hundred Years' War. And then, of course, he went back over to the French, and that was probably the, well, it was a severe blow for the English, and they, of course, ended up losing the Hundred Years' War when they thought they were winning. Philip the Good had a son, Charles the Bold, who had a daughter, Mary of Burgundy. Mary of Burgundy died very tragically in her 20s. She was killed by a fall from a horse. And she left two young children, Philip the Fair and Margaret of Austria. Philip the Fair, of course, inherited. He died, and you'll see his son, we'll talk about him, inherited from him. But let's just look at this map. I know you can't really see much of the details here, or really read it. It's probably not good enough to do that. But you can see this big brown area down here, the lower part, which is Burgundy. And then all of these different colored areas up here, which are parts of the lowland. And then that light green area, which is, Lorraine, is between them. And that is, of course, an area they've been fighting over for many centuries. And then at the top, you see the little chart with the different colors, and it's showing you when different principalities were added to Burgundy's territory. So, some of it was quite late, some of it was earlier. But the different there were counts and like the Count of Nassau. There were dukes like the Duke of Cleves. There was different territories. It wasn't just one nation state of the Netherlands. And so bits and pieces by inheritance and other methods get added to Burgundy's territories. But you see, they're not really adjacent. That's why they wanted that little green area there. Now, the art of the era that we're talking about, with the 15th century primarily, but a little bit either way, the art of that era has been called by a number of names. Flemish art, because the area of Belgium is often called Flanders or Flemish. It's not the exact borders. In fact, in present day Belgium, the two westernmost counties are East Flanders and West Flanders, with the capitals of Ghent and Bruges. Antwerp, of course, is another Flemish city. They were also called, I often use this term, early Netherlandish painting or early Netherlandish art. And I need to explain that a little bit. By early, we're just meaning it's before the 17th century. Sometimes the 17th century has been called the golden age of Dutch art. And being a 15th century specialist, I might take exception to that. The terminology is what it is, I guess. So when we say early, we're meaning it's before the 17th century and primarily the 15th century. Now, why Netherlandish? Well, we said the Netherlands, of course, is this territory in the lowlands. But the word is Nederlands, in Nederlandish, in the language that we call Dutch. It's also the same language as Flemish. They're the same language. They're Nederlands. But in English, we have a kind of misnomer for their name. We call them Dutch. Which really only refers to the North Netherlands, but also is derived from Deutsch, which means German. And although it's a Germanic language, it is not German. It's sort of in between English and German, actually. And so when art historians were writing about this period, they sometimes called their books by, as you can see, various names. Well, two of the most famous art historians who were scholars of this type of art, this art of this period, were Max J. Friedlander and Erwin Panofsky. Max J. Friedlander wrote a multi-volume tome, a book, and it was called the Alter Nederlandische Malerei. Obviously, he's writing in German because he's German. And that translates quite literally as early Netherlandish painting. So we just translate it and use that. What Max J. Friedlander did was look at all of this art. And he was the great connoisseur. He was the one who would attribute paintings to particular artists whose name we knew. And he would also take works of art who couldn't be attributed to those particular works and put them in groups and give them conventional names like the Master of the Lucy Legend or the Master of the Legend of Saint Ursula. And that has been the basis of our connoisseurship. Now, we come back and sometimes we disagree with him. We may argue about particular attributions. This was a wonderful beginning and a really great scholarship. Then, in the early 1950s, Erwin Panofsky wrote another book, and he was a German art historian. I'll tell you about that in a minute. But he was writing in English because he had come over to the United States, and he entitled his book Early Netherlandish Painting. So this terminology was reinforced, if you will, in the English language. Panofsky, I'll tell you a little bit about him because I will be mentioning him from time to time throughout the class. Panofsky was a German art historian, And he was in the United States giving a series of lectures at Princeton when Hitler took power. And he made a very wise decision. He decided not to return to Germany. He was Jewish. And sometimes that surprises students when they find that the greatest scholar of the iconography of Christian art, you know, of Christian iconography, is Jewish. But you have to remember that scholars do not just study things that they agree with or have some cultural connection to. For example, you could have a scholar who studies Nazi Germany and is not at all a Nazi. He doesn't agree with it at all. You know, American scholar, for example. So the same way, a Jewish scholar can study Christianity and Christian iconography, Christian art. He also did classical. Panofsky is known as probably the, you know, the most famous of all the art historians specializing in iconography. And I probably should tell you that I'm a grand student. I never met him. But my thesis advisor, my dissertation advisor, I should say, when I'm getting my PhD, was James Snyder. And James Snyder was a student of Erwin Panofsky. Now, you see another term up there. It's Les Primitifs Flamands, or translated, the Flemish Primitives. Primitive, what does that mean? Well, it means early, essentially. It used to be, in the 19th century, that they talked about the 15th century Italian art as the Italian primitives, and the 15th century Flemish art as the Flemish primitives. You never will see that used with Italian art today, although, you know, you might find some books because, you know, it was used in the past. It just was supposed to mean they were early. And the idea of that time was that the high Renaissance of Leonardo and Michelangelo and Raphael was sort of the epitome of art. And they had this idea, I guess, that the earlier people, you know, they were primitive. They weren't quite up to that pinnacle. I don't think we look at things pejoratively and primitive has come to mean, has come to have some negative connotations. But I think it was just supposed to mean early, and probably still does in the French. Number of the French and, of course, the French-speaking Belgium scholars would write their books and call them Les Primitifs Flamands, the Flemish primitives. And so that remained particularly in the French language. And at the the Royal Institute for Cultural Heritage, or the Institut Royal du Patrimoine Artistique, literally for artistic patrimony, is this wonderful institution in Brussels. And they publish a whole series of books on the southern Netherlandish painters, which is called Les Primitifs Flamands. And that's like the title of all of the series. And then they have it divided in things like the corpus, which usually every volume will take a different museum, or sometimes a group of museums in an area, such as the one we have in our library is the New English the New England museums and the works that they have of the 15th century Netherlandish artists. So that's where those terms come from. Don't get all bent out of shape about terms. They come in historically and we use them. Let's go back to our genealogy. Okay. And so if you're listening to this in the Art History 2 survey class, be assured, I'm not expecting you to remember the names of all of the Dukes of Burgundy. What I'm just trying to do is give you an idea of how the lowlands passed in, why they were the Burgundian Netherlands, why they were in the hands of the Duke of Burgundy, and then, later on in the class, why they were in the hands of the Spanish. And you're going to find out about that. When I was in school, no one explained it to me. and I had to figure it out myself. So here we have it. Remember there was Philip the Fair, or Philip the Handsome, he's sometimes called, the Duke of Burgundy. He married a Spanish princess, the daughter of Ferdinand and Isabel of Spain, and she's known as Joanna the Mad. Now, that's very sad. What happened was she fell in love with her husband. And remember, this would be a political marriage. And she really did. She really loved her husband. And he died fairly young. And when he died, she was distraught. And so that is why she is called Joanna the Mad. They had a number of daughters and one son. And that son, whom we see here depicted in a portrait by a Bernard von Orley, grew up to be the Emperor Charles V. He's sometimes called Charles of Ghent because that's where he was born. But more often, you'll see him just called Charles V, the Holy Roman Emperor. Well, he inherited the Netherlands and Burgundy from his father, Philip the Fair, the Duke of Burgundy. He inherited the king, he became the king of Spain because Joanna the Mad's only brother, Juan the Prince of Spain, who was actually married to Margaret of Austria, the sister of Philip the Fair, he died without any children. They died after only about a year of that marriage. And so only daughters were left. And of those daughters who were married to, you know, all sorts of people throughout Europe, only one of them had a son who could inherit. So Charles of Ghent inherited Spain from his mother. Now, from his grandfather and his grandmother as well, Joanna the Mad. And, you know, you've heard about his grandmother, Isabella the Catholic. If nothing else, Americans hear about her as the person who financed Columbus's voyage to the New World, you know, looking for India but finding the Americas. She's the same woman. Okay, he also inherited interest in Austria from his grandfather. I think it's actually his uncle who's ruling there, but, you know, but he's got some inheritance. His grandfather was Maximilian of Austria, the husband to Mary of Burgundy. And then he either inherited or he went out and conquered much of Italy. Oh, and then he got elected Holy Roman Emperor, which was a Germanic title. So essentially, he's ruling most of Europe. I mean, not the Scandinavian countries, and not France, and not England. But I guess not Portugal either. But, you know, he has broad territorial acquisitions. And that is how Spain acquired the Netherlands. So in the 16th century, Spain, the King of Spain, ruled the Netherlands until the later 16th century. We'll hear about that. Obviously, Charles couldn't be everywhere, especially when he's off fighting a war in Italy. So he had people appointed to rule in his stead as regents. And the regent of the Netherlands was Margaret of Austria, which was his aunt. And she married twice, but the husbands died, first to Juan the Prince of Spain, and then to Philip of Savoy. Then she's a widow, and I don't know, but I guess she said no more or something. But anyway, she then rules the Netherlands in the first half of the 16th century. Okay, what happened in the second half of the 16th century? Well, you probably know that in the early 16th century, starting, I guess, about, well, depends on how you started, but you know that there was this man named Martin Luther, who started a new movement, which we talk about as the Protestant Reformation. And one of the reformers, who was John Calvin of Geneva, went to the Netherlands, North Netherlands, and preached. And many of the people who lived in the Netherlands became what we would call Protestant. Spain, the inventor of the Inquisition, was Catholic with a vengeance, I guess I should say. And they sent in, well, the Duke of Alba was then the regent, and he brought in the Inquisition. And the result was religious war. And as you can imagine, it was a very, as all wars are, very bitter and very bloody. But when the dust cleared, as it were, the North Netherlands had become a separate country, the Kingdom of the Netherlands. They had become a Protestant country with a Calvinist state religion, which is known as the Dutch Reformed Church. And it's pretty much, in the United States, it's very closely allied to Presbyterian. The Southern Netherlands remained Catholic. They remained under the control of Spain. And today, if you go to Belgium, most of the churches are Catholic churches. Most of the people are Catholic. If you go to the North Netherlands, of course, now a lot of secularism and everything too, but predominantly Protestant. I will say one other thing too that was quite interesting. In the 17th century, interestingly enough, although they certainly had a state religion, the North Netherlands, the country that we call sometimes Holland and we speak of as Dutch for an adjective, was one of the most liberal places to live if you were of a minority religion. For example, if you were Jewish or Mennonite or some other religion that did not have a country which was your state religion. The North Netherlands actually, they did not persecute people for being of minority religions, or at least certainly not to the extent that happened elsewhere in all over Europe. Just kind of interesting, and you may know, the Netherlands still has a reputation for being very a liberal place. Okay, so if you want to be more general, when we talked about early Netherlandish painting, but we want to expand that into the 16th century, frequently the art of Northern Europe or of non-Italian Europe, and one of the questions, should Spain be included in that? And some books will have Spain as Northern Renaissance art, and some books will not have Spain, because Spain is geographically Southern, but as you can see, there was so much influence from Flanders. Artists particularly were coming down from Flanders and working in the courts of Spain. So, as I say, Spain is like, do we put him in with Northern Europe? Because it's non-Italian Europe. Okay. But at any rate, the art of Northern Europe in the 15th and 16th century is often called Northern Renaissance art because it is at the same time that the Italian Renaissance of the 15th and 16th century is going on, and also because there are some characteristics certainly that they have in common. There is a book that I had to read when I was an undergraduate. It was Otto Benisch's book on Northern Renaissance art. And one of the things he said was what one of the characteristics was empiricism. In other words, experience and the idea of the Northern artist going out and looking and painting with great detail and exploring, the visual universe, painting things like landscapes, for example, and very exact portraiture and religious work that, seems to be very realistic or very naturalistic. And he likened that, of course, to the you know, new empiricism that eventually develops in science, but also the age of discovery. You know, so the explorers are out discovering the new world and discovering more of the globe, and at the same time, the artists are discovering more of the visible world. The other term that you will often hear applied to this, and this particularly in Europe, you will hear some of the art of the 15th and 16th century called Late Gothic, or in German, Spätgotik. And that is because they see it, you know, as a continuation of the Middle Ages, of the Gothic period. Incidentally, the Gothic period has nothing to do with Goths. It's just that some of the Renaissance scholars didn't like it, didn't like the cathedrals with their, you know, towering spires and pointed arches and things. And they said, oh, this is barbaric. It's not classical, it's barbaric. And the barbarians, I guess, that they were most familiar with were the Goths, so they called it, oh, it must be Gothic. At any rate, we now use it as a non-pejorative term that just has been enshrined in history. I should also point out that there's what they sometimes call the Burckhardtian idea of the Italian Renaissance, like that it was a new, secular, separate society, very different than Middle Ages, has pretty much been abandoned. We now see the medieval influence well into both the North and the South, and both into Italy and other countries in Europe. And the continuation of some of the ideas, often expressed very differently in art, with this new, what they called it, the Ars Moderna, the modern art in the North. We often talk about the, you know, the more believable or illusionistic art of the Italian Renaissance and the Northern Renaissance.